Judging by your taste in cars, you are a motorist of a special breed, and you're probably no novice when it comes to automobiles. I love it when Porsche patronizes their customers. They said that in the 1983 Porsche 928S owner's manual. It's absolutely true. Here I am in an 83 928S in ruby red, if you can believe it. I actually bought it. I can't believe that I bought it. This has been one of the most impulsive purchases that I've ever made. Besides a pack of chewing gum and mints at the grocery store, Porsche 928s.
You're watching Everyday Driver. We make a TV show, podcast, and YouTube channels helping you find a car you'll love. This is our third long-term challenge, and we're returning to the cars that started the show. Join us for road trips and new adventures in these cars from the past.
Subscribe so you don't miss a thing.
I had a 928 when I was 27 years old. It was a 1988 928 S4, and I didn't really know what I was getting into. I just knew that I loved Porsches, but more importantly, I knew that I loved the 928. It had ingrained itself in me, not just in popular culture, and I love the classic front engine rear cabin pushed all the way back. I love that GT car look. And then when one came along, I bought it for $19,500, and I learned a lot. It was almost the beginning of my car education, my real car education. And so I worked on it. I learned to do various things myself, and I had to sell it because I needed the money. And ever since then, as you know, I've always wanted another one. And here I am, $13,500 later. I just bought it. I blame it on my sister because she said, "How'd you feel if you didn't buy it? You went away and you didn't buy it." It's almost like I had to. I still can't believe that I bought another 928. I don't need this car, but I wanted it. Deeply, I wanted it. I guess I'm the guy that likes all the non-911 Porsches. Don't get me wrong, I love 911s. But here I am, my first Porsche was a 928, and then my second Porsche was a Cayman. So I guess I love the GT cars and the beautiful mid-engine cars that Porsche makes. I don't know what's wrong with me. It's the disease. All I know is it feels right. I bought this in Washington, and here I am driving it back. It's got 122,000 miles when I bought it. I'm 594 miles into my trip, and it's almost like I'm resetting the car because it feels like, even though it was driven almost regularly, almost daily, it doesn't feel like it was recalibrated for high speeds. And I am proud to say I fixed that. You know when a car just kind of doesn't feel like it wants to go, it's been sitting for a while and you just want to blow it out and get the cobwebs out of there? That's what I've done. At first, it only wanted to cruise at about 75, 80. And then it inched on up to 85, 90. And then now it's happy at 100 miles an hour and over, which is what it was designed to do. This car was designed specifically to replace the 911. It was introduced in 1978, and it won the European Car of the Year Award, a sports car winning the Car of the Year Award. And it kind of rocked everybody back on their heels. It looked futuristic then. I don't think it looks as futuristic as I think it looks classic now, but it's a timeless design. I love the front engine, the long hood. I love the GT car thing. This 928 is only about an inch longer in wheelbase than the Cayman, if you can believe it. 97.4, that is seared into my brain for the Cayman. And this is just over an inch longer. It's not a big car, but compared to most Porsches, it feels kind of lumbering and big. But it's also only 3,350 pounds. That recipe is pretty good. First of all, Porsche was convinced that the 911 was on the way out. Right about the time, mid-70s, 356 was like 15 years old at the time, and they're thinking, on its way out. We need a new model. We need something that is going to capture not only European interest, but North American interest as well. And so they came up with this, what I think is still one of the most beautiful designs, the most beautifully designed Porsche ever. And I can't believe I'm saying that. Porsche, in their infinite wisdom, decided on a layout. The design was going to be a transaxle. So this car is a front-engine V8 with a transaxle you're almost sitting on. It's right between the rear seats, right back here. And then the battery is behind that, as is the gas tank. Porsche was going after a clear 50-50 weight distribution for this car, even though it's not a lightweight sports car per se, but 3350 isn't bad. And nowadays, 3350 is kind of a light car because this didn't have all the airbags and electronic sensors and stuff that adds weight over time. So this is actually fairly lightweight for a GT car. What's so interesting about the 928 that is it was built for speed. And sometimes you drive cars that you clearly know the continent they were designed and built on. This is even more specific. It's clearly the roads around Stuttgart. You want to get at high speed from one place to the next, you've got a 2-hour drive, and you can have the hammer down as fast as it can go. That's the recipe of the 928. It didn't really work quite as well in America because of speed limits, especially in the 80s. Speed limits weren't as high even as they are now. But ultimately, what they ended up doing was deciding to sell the 911 alongside the 928 as really two different models serving two different markets. And I'm really glad they did, because I can't imagine Porsche, the company, without 911s. I can't imagine them without 928s. I'm secretly hoping for a next generation 928, as have many people over the years, but I don't know if it makes good business sense now. It's a specialty niche car, but from a GT car standpoint, I still think this is one of the best recipes ever. Something very, very special about the 928. Porsche designed something called the Weissach axle. It's specifically designed to counteract lift-off oversteer through a corner. It doesn't want to kick out. It just goes straight up when you lift off the power. The thing that it does is plant this car in corners, unlike most cars. And the only thing you're going to be left wondering is, when are my tires going to let go? Because the car's hanging on. It's positioned and squatted through the corner, and that's what I love most about the car. When you're in the corner, you can start to feel things. A lot of people have tried to turn this car into a track car over the years. It's been usually successful. You can lighten this car up enough, and the wheelbase and the dynamics are there. They're actually fairly competitive, but it was never meant to be a track warrior. It was meant to do this, the long sweepers, and that's where it still shines. 40 years later, this car is still brilliant. This thing is running. It's easily keeping up with modern cars and passing a lot of them. It's got plenty of power. It's this unrestored 40-year-old car, and we're booking. Why aren't more cars like this? I'm just enjoying what Porsche has created here. I want to keep it alive. The dynamics, the bones are here. The recipe is here. The steering rack is vague. Cosmetically, there's a lot wrong with this car. It's 40 years old. The dash is cracked. 928s were known to have cracking dashes. So if you can find one that is clean, the price just went up. But I don't care. It's almost like having all these imperfections enables me to just enjoy the car. But mechanically, it's sound. There's no leaks. She's just running. And I love feeling the dynamics, the thinking of 40, 45, 50 years ago still being relevant now. For me, it's design. The design of this car that resonated so much with me. Every time somebody who knows what this is and sees this, they go, oh, 928, that's so cool. It still looks expensive, still. And this was $13,500, which makes me think, I'm not losing money on this. I don't know that it's going down anymore from here, because if I improve it, I think somebody is always going to want this car. And somebody's always going to want it because it's manual. Porsche built 80% of these with a 4-speed automatic transmission, because they thought GT car, you're on the road and this is where it shines. You want to go. But the manual brings it to life. I guess that's why I like it so much. I cannot get enough of it from any angle. I'm just amazed by this car. I love looking at it, and I love feeling like I'm driving art. It's rolling sculpture, and it's a GT car, and the sound. Front engine V8, 4.7 liter, naturally aspirated V8. This is only 234 horsepower. But get this, the way the engine was designed, it's more of a torque monster. It's 263 foot-pounds of torque. Going up hills, passing people, rarely do you need to shift, but you've got that torque in this, which just makes it go. It doesn't sound like a lot, and it's not, and I don't care. I love driving this piece of history. I love how this car looks. From a styling standpoint, I couldn't get over how this was a V8, because V8s need a lot of cooling, right? So you'd think, where's the intake? Look at this thing. It just needed the lower mouth breather down there, and they shoehorned a V8 into this thing. We have got to talk about the interior. Look how shallow the dash is. But that means the controls can just be laid back, and it actually opens everything up. To fit in here, you've got to have your seat laid really far back. And the instrument pod, this entire pod, when you use the adjustment lever, moves up and down with the steering wheel. So, wow, what a novel design. 1983. Porsche was already doing this. I like it because the gauges will never be out of sync with the steering wheel from where it should be. I've got a ton of space down here because, you know, the front wheel's way up there, so I've got plenty of foot space, and it's just the most relaxing, comfortable, long-distance cruising position ever. This was the granddaddy of the pop-up headlight era, too. And you know what? The taillights? I think this is the era, the first gen, that I like better than the second. I don't know what's wrong with me. I guess I needed another one. I like that I feel like a steward of this car in a strange way. Maybe I'll have it the rest of my life. Maybe I'll safari-ize it and create the world's only Safari 928. But maybe I'll just keep it and keep it mechanically maintained and focus just on that. And the best thing I can do for it is drive it, put miles on it. 122,000 miles in 37 years is low mileage. Once everything's sorted, these cars are known to just go. I find it interesting that a lot of Porsche enthusiasts kind of shunned the 928. I think you're missing out if you do. I think you're missing on something that this dynamic from Porsche was entirely different than the 911. Oh yeah, and the steering wheel is sticky from baking in the sun for 40 years. It's cracked and sticky. It's so old, but there's so much character here. Yeah, this is cool. One more thing, that is the ignition. Interestingly, on the 928, it's on the right. I think Porsche did that to keep the legacy and history of the 911 intact, and that unique special thing, the Le Mans start, start the car with your left hand while you're putting in gear with your right so you can get away faster. That was never the case with the 928. So all the transaxle era cars, you'll notice, have the ignition on the right. Porsche considers this the granddaddy of the transaxle era. Over the years, Porsche dramatically improved this car. Right about the 86-87 changeover, they went from a 16-valve engine to a 32-valve engine, and these engines are known to just go. Porsche wants their cars to be fast. I can't believe I bought another 928. What am I doing? I'm nuts. And yet it feels right. I guess I wasn't done with my first 928. So I had to go get another one.